I wouldn't say that I actively try to not play meta decks, but as it turns out, in any given format of Yu-Gi-Oh!, I tend to gravitate towards whatever I think is the best rogue deck. Now, this might be because I really hate playing mirror matches, and it might be because I don't like the play style of the meta decks, but I find that when you play rogue decks, there's a lot of other things that you have to account for than when you're playing a meta deck. And a couple months ago, well, more than a couple months ago at this point, I made a video very similar to this one where I talked about three problems with Yangtze Dinosaurs. Now, if you remember, if you were subscribed to me, Yangtze Dinosaurs was the deck that I played for months. Pretty much ever since the Dinosaur Structure deck came out, I played Dinosaurs right up until the ban lists that hit, Miscellaneosaurus and Lithosagam. But up until that point, I pretty much played them religiously. I just never played anything else. And I love that deck a lot, and I learned a lot when I made that video. Basically, in these three problem videos, my goal is to address what I think are the three biggest downfalls of playing that particular rogue deck in order for us to sort of collectively figure out a way to solve these problems. Because I don't believe that these problems happen in every single version of every single rogue deck that I play, but I do believe that they are things that are plaguing the deck currently that keep it from being the best deck or one of the best decks. So the deck that I've been playing a lot recently, as you may have seen or heard of, is Frog Paleozoics. Now, I love Frog Paleozoics. They're so much fun, but let's talk about three problems that are plaguing them today. First of all, the whole swap frog thing. Where do I start here? Well, anytime you open swap frog, your win percentage goes up like astronomically. It's just insane. Swap Frog is such a good card that even if you open it without another water monster, you're pretty likely to win that game, especially if you go first. Now, if you open Swap Frog and a water monster and you're going first, I don't want to say you have a guaranteed win because nothing in Yu-Gi-Oh! Is guaranteed. However, I would say that it is very difficult to lose, even against the best decks, if you can simply open Swap Frog and a water monster, which gets you to totally awesome. However, on the other side of things, if you do not open Swap Frog, it is pretty hard to win. Now, there are good hands without Swap Frog, but the hands where you don't have Swap Frog and you don't have enough good back row are really rough to play out of. Now, drawing Dupe Frog and not Swap Frog isn't the worst thing in the world. Dupe Frog has a pretty big defense. It also searches Swap Frog, but if you open like Ronin Toadin and nothing else, you're just in a really rough spot. And yes, there are some openings. I mean, the best case of the worst case scenario is opening like a Ronin Toadin or a Dupe Frog and then a couple Paleozoic trap cards, so you can hopefully stall your opponent for one turn and then use the Ronin Toadin or the Dupe Frog with one of the Paleozoics that you use to make it totally awesome and then hopefully stabilize after that. But that doesn't always happen. And this is like a huge problem because there aren't any ways to search Pop Frog going first that are reliable. So you can play cards like Pot of Desires and you can play Card of Demise, but then even if you play those cards, assuming they don't even get negated by Ash Blossom, you don't always draw into the Swap Frog, which makes it really tough to play. This is probably, of all the decks in competition right now, the one that's most reliant on a three of, and that's really rough. So how do I think we could fix this? I think the idea is that you just play other starter cards. Now, I don't necessarily know what those other starter cards are. I think that playing more ways to get to Swap Frog could be worthwhile to look into, but in general, I think all of those have been experimented with and proven to not be effective. I think of like Damage Condenser and Mother Grizzly cards that were played years ago to get this Pop Frog, but are probably too slow right now. But I think that Frog's just needing more starter cards. I don't know if that means like combining them with other engines, or if you just go to a tournament and hope you get lucky and open Pop Frog more than you don't open it. Because in that case, if you do get lucky, you'll probably win most of those games. Anyway, the other bad thing, the second one here, is that they're really bad going second. Well, maybe they're not always bad going second, but they are pretty bad at breaking boards. If you were able to stop your opponent with a hand trap, then the deck's actually not that terrible going second. Your trap cards are pretty good, but there are times against Spirals specifically that your hand doesn't do anything. So Spiral Sleeper is obviously really, really broken against Paleozoics. Because you have to set all of your cards, it can just rip apart four cards before you even have a chance to really do anything. But more importantly, Paleozoic Canadia, which is actually quite good when you go first for stopping Link summons, it can't be activated against Link monsters. So if you're going second against a Spiral field and all they have is Link monsters and Sleeper, and then they also have a Resort on the field, you can't even activate the Paleozoic Canadia just to get it into your graveyard, which basically means it's a dead card entirely, which is not good. When you're going second against a deck like Spirals, you absolutely need every card in your hand to do something. And when you have cards like Paleozoic Canadia that literally do nothing if your opponent doesn't have cards you can flip down, you're left in a pretty rough spot. But just in general, a deck that's so focused on traps is going to have a tough time breaking boards. Paleozoics and Frogs in general are really trying to stop your opponent before they make their plays. They don't really have that many forms of hard removal in terms of monsters. Yes, they have a lot of back row removal. Solemn Strike kind of deals with stuff that's on board, and there's a couple extra deck monsters that can deal with monsters that are on board, but if your opponent has multiple threats, you just really can't deal with them, and that's tough because pretty much every deck right now wants to go first and can make a really big board going first, which means if you don't have the hand trap to stop it, you're looking at a very uphill battle. Now, I don't think it's impossible to win going second, but I think very similar to the Swap Frog thing. If you're going second without drawing Swap Frog, you're like almost certainly going to lose. If you go second and you draw Swap Frog and you draw water, then you have a pretty good chance of coming back. But it's just the times where you're just going to open four trap cards and like a hand trap that's not good against your opponent's field. Like, let's say you open four traps and Rodentoten in your first five cards going second. Your opponent makes a huge board and then you draw Ash Blossom for turn. Now you basically have four cards to work with because the Ash Blossom isn't going to help an established board and the Rodentoten isn't going to help you besides being a defensive card. And then your four traps had better be good. If one of them's Canadia, now you're down to three cards, not to mention your opponent can just pop your back row with Twin Twister or Sleeper in the end phase, which makes it pretty rough. But moving on, I think I've dwelled on that enough. We can talk about the other thing, and that is evenly matched. So evenly matched is ironically really good and really bad for Frogs. So it's really good for Frogs because it actually does help you when you're going second. A lot of people, I think pretty much all the recent Frog Paleozoic tops have been playing evenly matched in the main deck, which is insane because it's obviously something you can only activate if you're going second before any other cards are played, but it's so good in that regard because Frogs, like I said, have such a hard time breaking through boards that a card like evenly matched just really secures wins and gets it to that simplified game state that you really want. Because all Frogs want to do is get to a simplified game state where they can summon Totally Awesome and negate every card their opponent plays. It's pretty straightforward. You're just trying to one-for-one trade your opponent down to nothing because all of your cards have really good card economy in the late game, and you just have a lot of longevity. But anyway, evenly matched is bad for Frogs because it almost instantly wins the game if you don't actually have a way to stop it. Now, I made a video recently, shout out to me, for the top 5 cards that you can use to stop evenly match, and the whole reason I made that video was because I was playing Frog Paleozoics and I was like, I am losing every single game my opponent has evenly matched. What are some ways I can counter it? Now, the obvious way is you can use Totally Awesome to negate it. I will say that that's not always as easy as it sounds, because what can happen is your opponent will enter their main phase one, use a card to bait the Totally Awesome, and then if you negate it, because I mean, if it's a card like Regeki or Darkhold that'll get rid of the Totally Awesome, of course you're going to negate it. If you negate it, your opponent can then enter their battle phase and wipe your whole board, and then you're obviously just going to lose that game right away. So what are some ways you can be evenly matched? Well, to save you from watching that video, I will just recap here. I think the two best ways, at least in Frog Paleozoics, are Artifact Lancia and Mind Crush. Artifact Lancia is just a good card in general. It also can't be taken out by back row destruction, especially if your opponent tries to preemptively destroy back row before using the evenly matched, which I don't know if they'll always do, but I think that they might do that sometime, so it's worth mentioning. But the Mind Crush is really cool. Mind Crush, I think, is great for a couple reasons. Not only does it hit the evenly matched out of your opponent's hand when they enter their battle phase, you also get to see every card in their hand besides the evenly matched, so you know exactly what to hit with all your trap cards. Knowledge is very powerful in Yu-Gi-Oh!, but especially when you have a deck that the whole point is to negate specific things, when you know what to negate, it just goes a lot smoother. Also, and this is probably the main reason I like Mind Crush, is Mind Crush triggers the Paleozoic cards. I think the best thing to play in Paleos is trap cards that are don't have any requirement for you to trigger them. Even if you miss with Mindcrush, you can still special summon the Paleozoic card, which means that if you're sort of in a backs against the wall situation, you can just flip up Mindcrush as long as you and your opponent both have one card in hand and purposely miss the call. I mean, you won't purposely miss it. You won't call like Wind Dragon of Ra, but you probably call something you think they might have. But even if you don't plan on hitting it, you can still summon the Paleozoic from the grave. And I know it sounds like a really fringe use. However, if you've played Paleozoics, you might know that there are times where it is perfectly acceptable and actually the correct play to use like the Dust Tornado Paleozoic on your own back row just to summon a Paleozoic from the grave so you can make Totally Awesome. Totally Awesome is that important that if you have to minus two to summon it, it's perfectly acceptable as long as your opponent is out of cards, because then you just negate everything they do and you win from there. It's pretty cool. It doesn't happen every single game, but it happens often enough to be worth mentioning. And I think Mindcrush is incredibly versatile in that regard. And also it counters the card that pretty much hard counters Paleozoic. So do I think Frog Paleozoics are terrible? Well, no. I mean, obviously I'm playing them. I think they're actually a lot better than people give them credit for. They're one of the most popular rogue decks in competition right now. If we're taking Trickstars out of the running for rogue decks, because they had so much representation at YCS San Diego, if we count the big three decks as Spirals, Magician, and Trickstars, I think that Frog Paleozoics are easily like the fourth or fifth deck of the format. And I think that a lot of players that have been playing this deck for years really have latched on to continuing to play the deck, and that's perfectly acceptable. I think it's a pretty good metagame choice, and Totally Awesome can protect your floodgates, which was the strategy that I took to YCS Dallas, and I think I only lost to one Spiral player at that event, and that was Full Power Spiral. So I think that Frog Paleozoics have a good future ahead of them, especially if you can figure out how to solve these three issues. But let me know what you think the issues of Frog Paleozoics are in the comment section below, and if there are any solutions for them. I'd love to hear you guys' thoughts. But anyway, I'll see you guys later.